So, good morning, ladies and gentlemen. And first of all, I would like to thank the organizers for giving me the opportunity to talk about FMDV interactions, host interaction in a model of persistently infected bovine cells. So, a few words about FMDV persistence, a prolonged subclinical infection. So, it is when live FMDV can be recovered from pharyngeal samples more than 28 days post-infection. So this is the original definition, but these days and with the recent literature, it's moving. This definition, it's changing. But up to 50% of ruminant animals become persistently infected after clinical recovery. The probability of viral persistence decreases with age. There is no convincing evidence of persistence in pigs. And persistence can be established irrespectively of adaptive immunity. So, but the duration of FMDV persistence depends on the species, but it was reported to be up to 5 years in African buffalo, up to nine months in small ruminants, and 3.5 years in cattle. So, about the transmission to susceptible animals, it's reported from buffalo to cattle. It's at extremely low rate of transmission. So, this transmission remains debatable, but it's an impediment for FMDV eradication. About the site of persistence, so, different anatomical sites of viral persistence have been described. Epithelium of dorsal nasopharynx, and also epithelium of dorsal soft palate, but also germinal centers of lymphoid tissues, palatine tonsils, namely in buffaloes. So, what about mechanisms of FMDV persistence? So, how is FMDV persistence established? How is it maintained? The precise mechanisms remain poorly understood, but research works provide clues towards understanding this persistence. So, I try to sum up briefly. A lot of work was performed in vitro and in vivo, and this work concluded to modification of viral factors, the fitness, some mutation, change of receptor usage, but also cell modification, so resistance to superinfections, modification of autophagy, and these are in favor of co-adaptation of virus and host cells. In vivo, also viral factors and cell modifications, and recently it was reported a downregulation of pro-apoptotic genes expression and overexpression of T regulatory cells related genes. So overall, there are many clues for host FMDV interactions who facilitate persistence of infectious virus. And it is why I present this work. So we are interested in study epithelial bovine cells persistently infected by FMDV to study such FMDV host interaction. So we have three parts. So first, we establish persistent infection in a cell line, the MDBK cells, and we collected persistent viruses. We also moved to primary bovine epithelial cells in collaboration with Jean-François Valarche and Sarah Eglund at the SLU in Sweden. And we have also an ongoing project about the interactome analysis of FMDV host interaction. So let's move on to the first part about the MDBK cell lines. So, we choose the MDBK, so they are bovine kindness cells. It's an epithelial bovine cell line. We show that it is permissive to FMDV infection. And interestingly, they have the ability to reconstitute cell monolayers after FMDV infection. And it's also they are also competent for type 1 interferon production. So we established persistent infection by subculturing the cells surviving to the first inoculation, and we were able to maintain the cells during 42 passages, so roughly 5 months in culture. So viral RNA and viral protein was still detected in highly passage cells, so passage 38 and 36. And infectious virus was also recovered until 36 passages post-inoculation, because the virus was still infectious. And we duplicate also this experiment, and we were able to subculture during 25 passages post-inoculation, and viral RNA was recovered until 18 passages, and as well infectious virus. We initiated the characterization of the virus recovered from MDBK cells, and we performed growth kinetics curves and also plaque assay, and we observed a similarity of plaque size shape and growth kinetics between the original inoculum and the persistent virus. And concerning the duplicate assay, we observed the same tendency, so no differences in shape or size of plaque. And viral production increases along passages, and then we lose persistence. And we also observed a mutation in the VP1 coding region at passage 23 after inoculation, a substitution in the VP1 to be investigated. So now we drew in the framework of the European project called Transcriptovac, we had the opportunity to get this collaboration with the Swedish people, so Jean-François Valarché and Sarah, and we work on primary bovine epithelial cells. So these cells are dorsal soft palate epithelial cells, so in this presentation I will call them DSP. So DSP were purified, propagated, and characterized at SLU. And they were characterized for integrin alpha V beta 6 expression, but also expression of cytokeratin. And the same work was made with alveolar pneumocytes, so AP, to be able to work with cells from sites where no persistence has been described before, so and known to not be a site for persistence. Sorry. So again, they were purified and propagated and characterized at SLU, and the same characterization with the expression of integrin, but also the characterization with the AP type 2 lamellar bodies. Staining and also cytokeratin staining. So, first work, we inoculate these cells with FMDV type O from the episode C in 2001 in France and UK. And as you can see, we monitor the cytopathic effect apparition and during 24 hours. And as you can see, complete cytopathic effect was obtained at 24 hours, both for DSP and AP cells. I precise that we work on the batch of cells propagated from the same animal. And we were interested in established persistence. So we subcultured infected DSP in AP cells, and the question was, if we are able to recover infectious virus. So 48 hours post-inoculation, 6 and 13 days post-inoculation, surviving cells were rinsed and medium refreshed, then propagated, and one passage was performed, and 20 days post-inoculation, we collected supernatants and inoculated it to IBRS2 cells, so porcine-sensitive cells, and also back on DSP cells. And the results are in this table. So we using the supernatant from the AP cells, we were not able to observe CPE, cytopathic effect. But for SP, the supernatant of DSP cells is able to lead to cytopathic effect. And the cytopathic effect was confirmed by antigen capture ELISA. Thus, overall, there is infectious FMD virus that can be recovered from DSP cells, not from AP cells, 20 days post-inoculation and one cell passage post-inoculation. And these results are consistent with sites of persistence, FMDV persistence in vivo. So we continue this work, and we have an ongoing experiment, still ongoing today. We try to establish persistence assay in DSP cells. These DSP cells were inoculated with different MOI, so 10 to the minus 2 to 10 to the minus 4. So CPO was observed, and we also observed that within 9 days, surviving DSP cells can gradually reconstitute monolayers. So, and at 21 days post-inoculation, we collected the supernatants of these infected DSP cells to inoculate IBRS2, but also to inoculate back the DSP. And we observe cytopathic effects. So infectious FMD virus can be recovered from supernatants of DSP cells at 21 days post-inoculation, one cell passage, but also 65 days post-inoculation, so five cell passages. And today, my colleague says that at 19 days post-inoculation and six passages, we have still genome detection, but also infectious virus. So to be continued. And I will conclude on everything at the end of the presentation. I will go now on and to talk about this FMDV host cell interactome analysis using the YES2 hybrid technique. So just to say some words about this method. So the YES2 hybrid method is a method known to discover, to identify protein-protein interaction. And it is based, in our case, it is based on the properties of this transcription factor GEL4 to be dissociated in two domains, so the DNA binding domain, but also the activating domain. And based on this property, protein of interest, so called the BAIT, can be fused to this DNA binding domain. So in our case, the BAIT was viral BAIT. So we cloned in fusion the different viral R from the FMDVO. And we use this BAIT to screen a cDNA library made from MDBK cell lines. And in this MDBK cell line, so the cellular prey are fused to the activating domain of GEL4. So if there is an interaction, there is an activation of the reporter genes, and upon conjugation, you obtain clone on the selective plates. And after, we have just to perform PCR and sequencing, then to identify the cell preys and to be able to construct this interaction map. So for the moment, we have tested all this viral prey and to obtain this result. So the main colonies were obtained for the 2C, and we identified 7 candidate interactions. We identified cellular genes already identified in the literature, but also new cellular prey. And for the 3D, we obtain 165 colonies, and we identify 155 interactions, leading to identification of 8 candidate interactions. So overall, we have 18 candidate interactions identified to be validated, so biochemically but also functionally, and affected potentially 3 signaling pathways: innate immunity, apoptosis, and autophagy. So I go on to conclude about the cellular models of FMDV persistence in bovine epithelial cells. We have established 2 complementary cellular models developed to study molecular determinants of FMDV persistence. And with the help of FLI in Germany, and namely with Michael here, in the framework of the Transcriptovac project, we will proceed to transcriptomic analysis of persistently, acutely, or MOC-infected cells, so MDBK, but also DSP cells, with potential comparison with AP cells. And we will continue the characterization of the persistent viruses to, in the way to identify mutation linked to persistence. And concerning the host-virus protein interaction analysis, we have 18 candidate interactions, and now to be validated biochemically, but also with functional validation of candidate interaction, namely using DSP. And we will also complete the YES2 hybrid screening for genomic region coding for proteases, because sometimes it's led to toxicity, and it's not so easy to use them, so we will proceed by cloning different domains of interest. And we will also complete this YES2 hybrid method using the ORF clone from persistent viruses for any mutation characterized. So 3 mutations are in the course of study. And in the future, we want to perform complementary analysis using cDNA library prepared from DSP or AP cells. So now I have just to acknowledge my colleagues. So in the lab, but also the I5 team also in the lab for interactomic studies, but also Jean-François and Sarah from the SLU, and Katharina, the postdoc, and thanks for the funding through the Transcriptovac project. And I will finish by you. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Sandra, for this nice talk. Are there any questions from the audience?
I'm sorry if you said this and I missed it, but I'm curious, in your primary cell cultures, DSP and AP, can you describe what was the pattern of infection microscopically when you looked at those cells by IFA or IHC? How many cells, and was it a diffuse pattern, or was it focal?
Sorry, I'm sorry, I didn't understand. How many cells were
played? A sense of how many, and what was the pattern? Was it foci of cells? Was it the whole monolayer got infected, or was it something in between?
Concerning the SP cells, all the monolayer was very attacked by the virus. For AP cells, it's almost the same. And you need very little viral dose to be able to infect the SP. So you have to be very careful if you want to recover some survival cells. But at the end, in 9 or 10 days, you have this complete monolayer. But and if you stain the cell with a monoclonal antibodies, this persistent cell, you have, I think it's also your question, you have some detection of antigen. You have very high viral level of RNA by RT-PCR. You have CT18, even after 6 passages, but you have very little antigen production, but it's consistent with other study. I think there is some steady state between the virus and cells.
And in the late phase, in the DSP cells, are you suggesting it's a non-cytopathic effect? that the antigen is there, but the cells are not dying.
In SP cells, you can observe some little plague, in fact. And it's interesting, and it's also using the MDBK cells, it's interesting because when you you begin to observe more and more plague, you know that your persistence assay is down and you will lose this persistence. So from one assay to another, you can have this difference of state between the virus antigen expression, I guess, and the cells.
So, very nice work, Sandra. So the work that actually one of our postdocs, Vivian O'Donnell, I recently published an actually very similar work in the choice of cells also, in terms of using pharyngeal derived cells. And one of the things that I was curious about, do you see a phenotypic change in the cells? Like, you know, there was kind of, in that paper, the bottom line was that there was like kind of co-selection of viruses and cells. So the cells that got persistently infected were different than the cells you began with. And the virus that got persistent, you know, from the persistence was also different from the original. Did you see a similar process? And a second question, did you see any crashes where after one, say, passage number 19, you have CPE again, and then the cells survive and come back? Did you see any of these waves of CPE in your cultures?
Okay, thank you. You know, to be honest, we are very inspired by your publication from Flammarion, of course, and we didn't study for the moment the receptor usage and the resistance to superinfection with other viruses, but it is planned to be done. And Jonathan also asked me about the evolution of virus of cells, because they are depleted of fibroblasts at the beginning, and how is the progression, if are they still epithelial cells? So morphologically they look like epithelial, but we have to work with Jean-François to get the right the antibodies and to test, but it is plain. And concerning the observation of plague, it's the same answer than to Jonathan. It's for the moment in this DSP cells, we can observe some very little plague if you compare with the mock infected cells. So it's very interesting, and we note and we make photo to say okay, and often we say okay, the persistence assay is well because we observe this equilibrium between cells and virus. But we want to really to compare with the AP.
Thank you very much. Any other questions from the audience? Yes, please.
I'm sorry, I think I missed somewhere, but for the East2 hybrid, the cDNA library prepared, is that from the persistently infected MDBK cell or the normal MDBK cell?
The cDNA library? No, regular mock infected cells.
It's a normal MDBK.
A pellet of mock infected cells, yeah.
Okay, so are you in future, are you planning to have from the persistently infected MDBK cell?
Not really, because I have to ask for money to my boss. But we will try to, as I said in my conclusion, to clone and to test, namely using the two hybrid system, to test persistent coding region from the persistent viruses. And we will also test the effect of this persistent coding region on the for example the early antiviral response.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I'd like to